Hi, my name is Dr. Kate Crowley, professor of practice here at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York City. We've created this set of Developmental Milestones webinars based on the CDC Developmental Milestones that are available online, both in Spanish and in English. One of the issues with the CDC ones online is that they're individual files, and so it's hard for people to see the progression. So what we've just done is taken the CDC Developmental Milestones and turned them into this kind of webinar tutorial. So we're looking at birth through three and the wide range of normal. I did this with my two of my graduate students, co-authors Gabby Stern and Tiffany Neira, and also the grad assistants Gabriela Amayo and Stefania Marchiatelli. They're all graduate students here at Teachers College, Columbia University. So the developmental milestones for cognition, those are all different people with different wide ranges. So around 2 years old, baby starts to pay attention to faces. And then they begin to follow things with their eyes and recognize people at a distance. Again, at 2 months, they start to act bored if the activity doesn't change. They cry, they get fussy. Have a look at that. Around 4 months, they start to be able to show whether they're happy or sad. Those laughter starts to come out of them. Now, some babies start laughing as early as 2.5 months, 3 months. Others, babies might take a little longer, but around 4 months, you want to see that kind of laughter that happens and then the sadness. Also around 4 months, they begin to respond to affection. At 4 months, they start to use their hands and eyes together, such as seeing a toy and reaching for it. I remember my daughter, Caitlin, reaching around that age, around 3 months, for the mobile object that was above her. Then they follow things with their eyes from side to side. They can watch things go from side to side. They watch faces so closely, it's like a laser focus on their adults' faces. They recognize familiar people at a distance. Let's have a look. And also around 4 months, they'll start to reach for a toy with one hand. They're ready to grab in and bring it into their world. They look around at things nearby. Let's have a look at that. That's 6 months. That's 6 months. And then at 6 months, they bring things to their mouths. Sometimes this happens earlier. If a baby is teething, you'll often find more things in their mouths, whether it's their fingers or something, some kind of a pacifier or something to soften those poor gums as the teeth come in. At six, they also start to show that curiosity about things and try to get them and bring them into their world. They begin to pass things from one hand to the other, start at 6 months. Then around 9 months, they watch the path of something as it falls. So let's watch that happen. They start to look for things that they see you hide, and they go look for it. Now, that object permanence, where they know something is gone, happens a little earlier, but when they start to look for things, not they just know it's somewhere else. At about 9 months, they start to play those routine games like peekaboo, or one of the games of Dominican mom showed me a long time ago, was tope, 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 where the mom or the therapist and the little child would tap their heads, their foreheads together. Tope!
Hey, get me. Hi!
Also, they start to put things, more things in their mouths again. We saw that earlier. They move things smoothly from one hand to the other. So they're starting to develop greater coordination across hands from one side to the other. This is when they start to lovely picking up those little Cheerios and putting them in their mouths, their little delicate fingers. At 1 year, they start playing things and exploring things like shaking, banging, throwing, starting to really engage with their toys. That's about 1 year. Then they find things hidden, and they find it fairly easily. So you hide something from them, and they figure out how to get into it, how to find it again. About 1, then they start to look at a picture or thing when it's named.
Where's the dog? Woof, woof.
They might start to copy their gestures. Now, you can see little babies before 1 year old doing that. You're the itsy bitsy spider, those kind of things, or simple gestures. This is, I think, where the moms about 9 months, they start to do the signs, the single signs to help their children, but you know, that kind of thing. They start to use things correctly. For example, they might know how to drink from a cup. That's what they use in their family. About 1 year old, they start to bang two things together, making a lot of noise, having a party, really engaging with the environment. They begin to put things in a container and take things out of a container. Then we have all our little plastic things where they have the different shapes, but they put things in and take things out, put things in and take things out. Another thing, they might let things go without help. So they'll turn and hand it over to an adult at around 1 year old.
Put it on.
Put it on top. There you go, I'm not gonna.
They'll poke with their index finger. So remember a few months ago, they were starting to do the Cheerios. Now they're poking with an index finger. And they'll follow simple directions like pick up the toy, come over here, put that down.
Put it on.
Put it on top. There you go, I'm not gonna.
At 18 months, they start to know what ordinary things are used for. For example, a shoe, a brush, a comb, a spoon. They start to know, look at that little one is really working at putting that shoe on for the reason they know. Then they start to point to get the attention of others. Joint regard, of course, happens much earlier, but when they start pointing to get the attention. Look, mommy. At 18 months, they start to show interest in a doll or a stuffed animal by pretending to feed. So here's the beginning of that representational play. And they might, if they're schooled in this, they might point to one body part. Of course, I have a story of my friend Sarah when my daughter Caitlin, who's 25 now, but when she was 3 days old, my dear friend Sarah came over. She's not a therapist, she's not a teacher, she's a theatrical agent. She held Caitlin, she said, oh, you're so adorable. And then she went on to go eyes, nose, mouth, cheeks. And I thought, wow, this is how body parts are introduced in my culture. So it depends.
Where's your mouth? Where's your ear?
Very good. At 18 months, they can scribble on their own. Gotta make sure they got the pens and the paper. And they can follow one-step verbal commands without any gestures. So are there any prompts? Is there, look over there, go over there and get the whatever? Or do you say, go over there and get the whatever?
Or go wash your hands. Thank you. Can you cut the water off from his driver?
Now around 2 years, they start to find things when hidden under two or three covers. It's an interesting developmental milestone. They begin to sort shapes and colors, the square, the triangle, the circle, the oval. They complete sentences and rhymes in familiar books. Of course, again, depending on their exposure to books, but this little boy is doing it.
Two little monkeys sitting in the tree. Tease Mr. Crocodile, you can't catch me. Allows clues to crocodiles, quiet as can be, and
snatch a monkey out of the tree.
That's right.
They start to play more make-believe games. So here's where the cognitive play, they start to do maybe at two more representational games, more make-believe games. They're not truly at symbolic play, but they start to begin to develop those play structures, those play ladders that they have, where different things start to happen and make-believe. Here we go, builds a tower of four or more blocks this is one of those that's in the psychology tests, the nonverbal part. You just have to be careful. I had a psychologist who would come and evaluate these little preschoolers, turning EI to preschool or preschool to school age to kindergarten. And he would put the towers of four and say, make a tower, make a train, and they couldn't do it. Why? Well, I worked at United Cerebral Palsy and the kids had cerebral palsy, so it had nothing to do with cognition. So please, please, please consider the child's background and the child's physical capacities when you're assessing cognition. They might use one hand more than another, so starting to develop dominance at two. They could follow two-step commands, clean up and push your chair in. Again, without visual or physical prompts.
Good jumping,
Jude.
Come up here. Come up here.
Carter, I think they opened the trash.
They could name items in a picture book. If we're into a labeling culture, cat, bird, dog, what's this? What's this? What's this? Is that a plane? Mommy, plane. No, honey, that's a helicopter. There's certain cultures, mine included, where the big focus on labeling. Other cultures can focus on other things like function or description.
What's that?
A lion.
They can work with toys, with buttons, levers, and moving parts around three. Sometimes this is when I become the favorite aunt or when I bring the cash register. So they bring that cash register and they can become like a salesperson in a store and make all those things move and ring and open up. Then they start to really do make-believe with dolls, animals, and people. So the play still begins to develop further and further. You've seen that we've seen make-believe, representational play, symbolic play. So we're moving across the kind of categories of play that you would expect as children grow older. Around here, they might love being in the costume area or the dress-up area or something like that. I remember my daughter lived in costumes from about 2 till about 6. Peter Pan for about 6 months, Supergirl. So around 3, then they can do puzzles with 3 or 4 pieces. Again, I know this is in the cognitive tests. I always talk about in my family, we are big puzzle people, not me. I will buy the puzzles. I'll hang around while people do them. I'll do some of them. It's not something I love, but many people in my family love to do it. And we would go on family vacations with a 500 or 1,000 piece puzzle. And people would sit around. It's a way to get to know each other and talk. My daughter had, I think it was 250 maple blocks in our house. We build all kinds of things in our living room with her and leave them up. We had the one block puzzle with the huge knob, the one piece puzzle. We had all this stuff. Now, when my daughter would be given this puzzle, she could do it in a second. But other kids who don't have access to puzzles, because it is something you expect in educational settings and from families that are educated to know that these puzzles have some value, just have to make sure when you're doing an IQ test, you don't assume everybody's had the same past experiences. Understanding what two means. So we'll watch that.
Can you put two goldfish in that cup? Very good.
Copies a circle with a pencil or crayon at 3. Turns pages one at a time. You're probably getting sick of me saying this, but there are kids who grow up without books. And so if you're assessing a 3-year-old who doesn't have access to books and you hand them a book and they don't turn the page, it may not be because they have a cognitive problem. Build a tower. So here's another example. Those are the kind of books, blocks we had in our house. Huge installations across our living room. Screws and unscrews jar lids. So that's the end of it. And again, this is Dr. Kate Crowley. And I hope you enjoyed it. There's 3 more. So that was cognition. We have physical, we have communication, and we have social emotional. Thank you very much.